since Vatican II, we have a new humanism, or integral humanism, again, which was condemned by Pius VI because of its liberal revolutionary tenets. But the next step, Christopher, and this is key, because again, this kills the state of Aquinas position, is this: it's going to turn into secular humanism. So it's a slide. It's a slide away from truth. So we're now at the new humanism, integral humanism. The next step is secular humanism, which literally is, will be a church free of dogma, okay, of tradition. Right.
Well, that's actually, you know, I was quoting before that one piece from St. Pius X, but... He actually explains that he says, you know, again, when speaking about liberal Catholicism and the liberal Catholicism of what the Second Vatican Council is, he says here, quote, "And now, overwhelmed with deepest sadness, we ask ourselves, venerable brethren, what has become of the Catholicism of the Sion? Alas, this organization which formerly afforded such promising expectations, this limpid and impetuous stream, has been harnessed in its course by the modern enemies of the Church, and is now no more than a miserable affluent of the great movement of apostasy being organized in every country for the establishment of a one-world Church, which will have neither dogmas, nor hierarchy, nor discipline for the mind, nor curb for the passions, and which, under the pretext of freedom and human dignity, would bring back to the world the reign of legalized cunning and force, and the oppression of the weak, and of all those who suffer toil, who toil and suffer." And then he in the next sentence, he goes into where this is coming from. He says, quote, "We know only too well the dark workshops in which are elaborated these mischievous doctrines, which ought not to seduce clear-thinking minds," end quote. Those dark workshops are the workshops of Freemasonry. And again, he's talking about the movement of apostasy, and he's talking about a one-world church of apostasy, and he's talking about no dogmas, no hierarchy, and he's using human freedom, human dignity. And this is all what we're getting from the conciliar church. We're getting human dignity. You know, we're getting freedom, freedom of conscience, liberty of conscience, you know, all of this up, it's a complete upheaval. It's taking the foundation and raising it, destroying it, however you want to describe it. It's destroying the foundation of Christian civilization from the quote that you had given of St. Pius X earlier, you know, where he said the foundation can't be laid other than how the church has laid it. But now we're seeing that inversion, and that's why you're seeing legislation being passed throughout the world that runs completely contrary to natural moral law, divine law. I mean, even today, I saw one cartoon network is putting out a transsexual superhero for kids as young as age 2. I mean, it's
growing sicker by the day, there's no doubt.
It's, I mean, if you can't see that this is a satanic inversion of truth, you know, of God versus the city of God versus the city of man, then I don't know what else, you know, how else to for people to be able to see, but it's disturbing to say the least. I'm sorry about it, I might have digressed there.
No, that was a perfect quote to tie in, and it's just amazing how this mystic, Blessed Aunt Emmerich, literally echoes what Pope St. Pius X said. And of course, this was in a mystical experience. This wasn't something she sat down and theologically wrote.
Right.
This was a mystical experience that she had written down. And furthermore, she progresses here. She says, amongst the strangest things that I saw, there were long processions of bishops. Their thoughts and utterances were made known to me through these images issuing from their mouths. Their faults towards religion were shown by their external deformities. A few had only a body with a dark cloud of fog instead of a head. Others only had a head. Their bodies and hearts were thick like vapors. Some were lame. Others were paralytics. Others were asleep and staggering. And here's the tell-all here. I saw what I believed to be nearly the whole bishops of the world, but only a small number of them were perfectly sound. And how perfectly that describes our time, where we have few bishops, okay, in the society of St. Pius X, okay, who are resisting. They're resisting this revolution. And it goes back to her other quote where she saw, you know, only 100 or so priests. Okay, so I mean, she's basically making this overall picture, okay, that the majority are not following the true faith, because she goes on to say later here, she says, "I then saw everything that pertained to Protestantism was gaining the upper hand, and the Catholic religion fell into complete decadence. In those days, faith will be very low, and it will be preserved in some places only, in a few cottages, and in a few families which God has protected from the disasters and war." So clearly, she is leading us into what we have just talked about, how we're heading into these great chastisements, and how, due to Vatican II, Protestantism has literally overtaken the world. And it's quite sad, and I suppose to a certain extent disheartening, okay, where when we're talking with someone who's in the conservative church, they truly have a different notion of who even Jesus is. I know, graduating from a highly Novus Ordo college, okay, I was around the charismatic movement, and it's a completely different ideology. You know, I can remember, again, not subjectively trying to slander or cause scandal here, but, you know, after, you know, injuring yourself or stubbing your toe, it's, you know, immediately run to a charismatic mass to get healed. There is no cross anymore, okay? Right. It's all about me. It's all about... Yeah. I need. And this is the kind of perverse, backwards thinking, honestly. And I've stated this numerous times before in my newsletters, and I will stand behind it. You know, it's just a mere reflection upon how the new mass, there's very little grace, maybe not even hardly any grace at all, that you're receiving from those sacraments. Souls cannot properly think anymore, okay? And Blessed Anne Emmerich echoes this. She states that even in the bishops, there's a dark cloud of fog in their head. There's dark clouds over their hearts. I mean, this one could make an reference to it being in a state of mortal sin or not fully getting the picture, so to speak. You could leave that to open interpretation.
Yeah.
And our next quote here, which I believe we talked about very briefly here earlier, this is almost gives me goosebumps every time I see this, where she states, "I see many excommunicated ecclesiastics who do not seem to be concerned about it, nor even aware that they are. If they are ipso facto excommunicated when they cooperate to sick enterprises, enter into associations, or embrace opinions upon which an anathema has already been cast. I see very clearly from the errors, aberrations, and the countless sins of men." And, you know, essentially she goes on here a little bit more, and to paraphrase her, she kind of finishes with saying, "They were building a great and strange, extravagant church," again, which will be human. "Everyone was to be in it. Everyone was to be admitted in it, was to be unified and to have equal rights," again, speaking about this invalid ex cathedra that will come to play, "evangelicals, Catholic, sects of every description, such was to be of this church of darkness," where this new church we see now, which is, we're leading and we're heading into that direction of it being completely apostate. And I know you talk about this a lot in your work on different social media sites, and I believe you talked about it earlier, but through the Infallible Magisterium, Council of Trent put the rites, okay, in this particular case, we're talking about the Latin rite, put it under anathema, and not even a pope could touch it. You were correct in saying Canon 13, Session 7, okay, and it follows. It says, "If anyone says that the received and approved rites of the Catholic Church won't to be used in the solemn administration of the sacraments, may be condemned, or without sin be omitted at pleasure by the ministers, or be changed by any pastor of the churches whomsoever into new ones, let him be anathema. Okay, and so this is another reason in prudence why we must avoid the Novus Ordo.
Right.
And this was just a reiteration of Pope Innocent III that said if any future pope tries to change the sacraments, it must not be followed. And again, at the Council of Florence, Pope Eugene IV, alongside his prominent theologian, Cardinal Torquemada, essentially reiterated the same thing. And so outside of just the Freemasonry aspect, which obviously would put one into an automatic excommunication position, she perfectly describes how modernism and modernists who are souls who are following the synthesis of all heresies,
right.
Okay, that they are objectively speaking not members of the church, objectively speaking. And it's amazing how she so perfectly describes